Wibmer of the University of Pennsylvania, and the title is the Steep Torsors for Different Algebraic Groups.
Okay, so thanks a lot for giving me the possibility to speak here on this nice occasion. So I'll be speaking about torsors for different algebraic groups, and this is joint work with Annette Bachmeier, who is in Bonn at the moment. So, really, the central question for this talk is how can we classify torsors for groups divided by difference equations? So I'll explain in a minute what a torsor is, but I'd like to start with an example. So let's fix a difference field. This is just any field with an endomorphism. And so, for example, you can take the field of rational functions in the variable alpha, and the endomorphism, which we'll always call sigma, is the shift on alpha. And let's look at that a linear difference equation over that difference field, and then the solution set, all solutions of that linear difference equation, they are naturally the subgroup of the additive group. So that's actually the first example of a group defined by a difference equation. That's an example of what we call a difference algebraic group. Yes, so like something very well known, of course, if you have two solutions to the homogeneous difference equation, if you add them, you have again a solution. So this is why this is a subgroup. But if you look at the non-homogeneous equation, so for any point A in the base field, you have the associated non-homogeneous equation. This is, of course, not a subgroup unless A equals 0. But this is what we call a torsor. So the group, so the solutions to the homogeneous equation, they act on the solutions of the non-homogeneous equation. And the action is just by addition. So, of course, this is something you know very well. If you have a solution to the homogeneous equation and you add it to the solution of the inhomogeneous equation, you have another solution of the inhomogeneous equation. And that this solution set XA is a G-torsor. So what does it mean to be a G-torsor? It means that whenever you have two points, there exists a unique element in the group transforming one point to the other point. That's the definition of the torsor. And so here, in that example, you would just take two solutions. So if you take two solutions of the inhomogeneous equation, you look at their difference, then the difference is in the group, and that's, of course, the unique group element which transforms one solution to the other. And then a natural question to ask here is then, you're given that difference algebraic group, and you can ask, is every torsor for the difference algebraic group isomorphic to one of those very simple torsors? And so that the theory, which I'd like to speak about, is exactly built to answer this type of question.
By isomorphic, you mean over some given base field?
Yeah, everything is over K, over that different field K. Yeah. Right, so that's the other one.
And again, you mean isomorphic in what category?
Yeah, I'm gonna come to that. Yeah. So in the first section, I'll do the basic definitions and examples, and in particular that question should be answered there. And then the main result is in the second section. So in the second section, I introduce this cohomology set H1, and the main result is that this cohomology set actually classifies torsors. And then in the third part, I'll explain some applications to this what we call sigma-Galois theory. So one reason why people are interested in those groups defined by difference equations is that they occur naturally as Galois groups in a certain Galois theory. And I'll explain two applications of this H1 business to this Galois group. So one application is about the uniqueness of the solution rings, and the other application is more in the direction of the inverse form. Yeah, so let's start with the basic definition. So for me, a difference ring is just any commutative ring with any endomorphism. So that's like in differential algebra you look at rings with a derivation, but in difference algebra we look at rings with an endomorphism. And so a basic example of this is you can take the ring of all sequences say in C with a component-wise addition and multiplication, and the endomorphism is the shift. So you shift the sequence one step to the left. Now throughout the talk, I'll fix a difference field. I'll always work over a fixed difference field K, so just a field with an endomorphism. For example, again, take the rational functions with the shift. And so we want to speak about difference equations over K, or we want to speak about difference polynomials over K, but a difference polynomial ring over K, this is a polynomial ring in infinitely many variables, so the variables here are by 1, 2 by n, sigma by 1, sigma by n, sigma squared by 1, and so on, so we can, there's a natural extension of sigma from K to this ring, which is really just given by making the use of how we name the variables. And so whenever we have a set of difference polynomials, we can speak about their solutions, and to be precise, we have to say, like, where are we looking for the solution? And so the only structure you need to make sense of what a solution is the structure of what we call a K-sigma algebra. So given the difference with K, K-sigma algebra is just a K-algebra equipped with an endomorphism, which we usually also call sigma, such that if you restrict sigma to K, you get back the sigma on K which you are already given. And yeah, so the solutions are what you think it is. Okay, so just plug in the abstract sigma and specialize it to the concrete sigma which you are given on S. So for example, using this formalism, so taking K to be C with the constant endomorphism considered as a subset of the ring of sequences as the constant sequences, you can say, okay, the Fibonacci sequence is an element in the solution set of this difference polynomial. And but if you take together all those solution sets, so for every x, what you really get is a functor from the category of K sigma algebra to the category of sets. So that's what we call a difference variety. The difference variety is essentially just a solution set of a system of algebraic difference equations. So if you don't like the functors, you can also just think, okay, take a sufficiently large K-sigma algebra and just take the solutions. Yeah, so that's a difference variety. And then a difference algebraic group, you can just say it's a group object in the category of difference variety. But in other words, it's a group defined by difference equation. Okay, so the set is defined by difference equation, and also we require that the group multiplication is given by difference equation. Let's see some examples. So linear algebraic groups are examples of difference algebraic groups, just because algebraic equations, you can think of them as being difference algebraic equations. So that's the example we already had. Any linear difference equation defines a difference algebraic subgroup of the additive group. There's also plenty of different algebraic subgroups of the multiplicative group, for example, this one, but you can also take other powers of sigma here. And another example would be, you can always, if you have an algebraic group defined over the constants of the basis, you can always take the constants there. So for example, you can take SO2, and then you can take all matrices fixed by sigma. So here, sigma is applied to every entry of the matrix. Maybe the last example is something like a unitary group. You look at all invertible matrices such as sigma of G transpose times G is the identity matrix. Those are all examples of groups defined by difference equations. And as you can see here, actually those are all subgroups of some algebraic groups, and that's not a coincidence. One can actually show that every difference algebraic group is isomorphic do a difference algebraic sum of some algebraic group. So you can always assume that the group multiplication is actually given by polynomials and not just by difference polynomials. Okay, so that's the basic definitions, and now we come to the torsors and to H1. So a torsor is a difference variety with an action of a difference algebraic group. So from now on, G is always some fixed difference algebraic group, and we assume that it is acting on a difference variety, and we say that X is a G torsor if that map here is an isomorphism. So the map maps G X to G applied to X and X.
What is an action?
The category is the category of difference varieties.
Okay. Different polynomial maps.
Yeah, difference polynomial maps.
Everything affine.
Everything affine. Yes.
Sorry.
Yeah. Oh, nine. It's perfect. Yeah. Okay. So that's it. So another way to say this is you can say, okay, for any pair of elements in X, there exists a unique element in the group transforming one element to the other element. So this is how you can express it as a commutative diagram. And so there's always the trivial example. Just take X as the group itself, and that G act on it by left multiplication. Then any torsor isomorphic to such a torsor is called a trivial torsor.
Yes. So these statements about you giving a unique G, we can check this by evaluating on all S? Or?
Yeah, so this X, yeah, so this holds for all S. Yeah. Yeah, so I'm not, I sort of stopped writing the S, like here. I'm not writing the S anymore because you can sort of see. It just makes things easier not to write yet. And you can just think, okay, you're taking points in like in some really big thing. Okay. And of course there's also some non-trivial examples. And
you mean something more than that. Because you mean it's true for any extension of your difference field.
Yeah,
not
for,
just
for
in
any
some
S.
Very big one.
Yeah, that's equivalent. Like if the big one is really big, it's equivalent. Yeah. Okay, so let's look at this example. So the group is the subgroup of the multiplicative group, where the square is 1. And it should be fixed by sigma. And then the variety should be all elements on the line, also whose square is 1, and it's not fixed by sigma, but it's a negative. Okay? And there is a G acts on X by multiplication. And yes, you see, because sigma of G is G, this the second equation, sigma of X equals minus X, is preserved. And yeah, let's try to see that this is really a G torsor. But just take two elements in X, then if you look at their quotient, you see that the quotient lies in G, and that's a unique element transforming one element to the other element. And okay, so why is this this a non-trivial example? Well, let's just look at the k points of X. So you see if X squared is 1, then inside k, it has to be 1 over minus 1. And then, but 1 over minus 1 is fixed by sigma. So x of k, so there's no k points. X of k is empty. In fact, you see that x of l is empty for any difference field l. Okay? So x does not have a point in any difference field.
What?
X
does
not have a point in any difference field.
Yeah, so look, if
X is a finite state in a field.
That's yeah. So if do you have to plug in?
Yeah.
Yes, of course. Yeah. Okay. So it's just two. So the field is 2 points.
Well, G has two points, but X has none.
Yeah, but it has some interesting points in some difference rings, which are not fields. Okay, so you can recover X from its points in different rings, but not from its points in difference fields. Because in different fields, it's always just one. Yeah, so and it, yeah, so any difference right, any non-empty difference right, it has a point somewhere, and so X becomes critical somewhere. Maybe not in a field expansion, but in some ring extension. So every G torsor becomes trivial after some base extension to some ring. Okay, yeah, let's look at an example. So that's the unitary group we've seen before, and we'd like to write down some torsors for the group. So in fact, so pick any invertible matrix over the base field, and then look at this set of all X, such that sigma of X transpose X equals A. And so we claim that this is a G torsor. And let's look at it. So the action of G on X is given by multiplication, and this short computation here verifies that this is well defined. So we have to check that if G is in G and X is in X, that G times X is again in X, and this is exactly what the computation does. You find here in the middle, you find sigma of G transpose G, so this is the identity here. You can see that things work out. And if you take, then to show the torsor property, you have to take two points in X, and you have to show that there is a unique element in the group, transforming one point to the other point. And so really what we have to check is that X times Y inverse lies in the group. So of course, X times Y inverse is going to be the unique element transforming Y to X, so you only have to check that this element actually lies in the group. And this computation tells you, okay, that's fine. And but then the interesting question to ask is if every G torsor is of that form. So more precisely, is every G torsor isomorphic to such a G torsor? And that's sort of the typical situation which you often find. So whenever you have a group and you stare at it long enough, you'll be able to write down some natural examples of G torsor. But then the hard question is to know if you found all of them. Yes?
I'm not quite familiar enough with the unitary group off the top of one's head. What kind of points does this group have in different fields? I mean, does the torsor have in different fields? I mean, it's pretty empty. So the previous one, all the torsors were always empty for every field.
Oh yeah, so I don't think so. This one is not coming out of the empty.
It has points.
Yeah, this one should have points.
Yeah.
I think it has like difference dimension zero. So, yeah. The group should have difference dimension zero. So you can write it like sigma of G is something.
Yes.
So sort of there's no free sigma.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Yeah, and so you can ask, is every torsor of the form? And then you can also ask a bit more, you can ask like, and when are two such torsors isomorphic?
What do you mean by of this form?
Okay, meaning isomorphic to a torsor like this. So given any torsor for G, can you find an A such that this torsor is isomorphic to this?
You mean really this one particular G?
Yeah, G is fixed. G is this one G. So what we want to do is, given that difference algebraic group, I want to understand all the torsors for that group.
So you mean
I want to classify all of them.
You see G embedded into some algebraic group, and then you
not
want to
really,
see X.
Yeah. That's not a point.
So I don't understand what the of this form means. X has been a translate of.
No, so we're given that group G, a different algebraic group G. I've written down a couple of examples of torsors, but then just given any torsor, I don't know wherever it lives, just given any torsor, I ask you, is it isomorphic to one of those I've just written down? That's the type of question I want to answer.
Okay.
And that's the type of question that theory is, the theory of H1 is built for.
And G-torsion.
Yeah, isomorphic as a G-torsion. Meaning isomorphism of different varieties, also respecting the operation of the group. Alright. Yeah, so let's go to the definition of H1. So eventually we're gonna have an H1 which only depends on the group and on K. But for now we'll first have an H1 which also depends on some K sigma algebra B. Okay, so for any K sigma algebra B, I'm gonna now define some set, and that's H1. And then later we'll see how that is any useful. So for any different algebra B, we have those five maps. So the first one, the first rules are inclusion into the first and second vector, and then those three maps correspond to the three possible choices of putting a 1 into this threefold tensor. Yeah, so here are the maps. And so G is a functor, and you can just apply G to these five maps to get. So those five maps here are morphisms of K different algebra, and so here you get morphisms of groups. You have these five morphisms of groups. We call them. So we're going to use those five morphisms to define H1.
In the same direction?
Yeah, G is covariant. Yeah.
Okay,
yeah. So really this is just like if all is happening here is you have a solution to some equations in B, and then from this you get a solution in B tends to B, just by considering B as a subring in B tends to B. So basically on the solutions there's not much happening here. It's just you consider the solutions as living in a bigger ring, essentially.
And the sigma of the tensor is just applying it in each.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Now let's define, we're gonna use those five maps to define what we mean by a co-cycle. So a co-cycle is an element chi in G of P tensor B, which has a certain property. So given an element here, that here our chi lives here, we can find three elements here in G of B tensor B tensor B. And we require some relation to hold between those three elements. And this is the relation here. We want that delta 2 of chi is the same as delta 1 of chi times delta 3 of chi. And this times here is really the multiplication in that group. Okay, so a co-cycle is an element here in G of B tensor B such that if you apply those three maps, you have this relation, and then H1 is defined to be cosine modulus some equivalence relation, and this equivalence relation, it looks a little bit like conjugation, but this equivalence relation is using those two maps here. So to define what the cosine is, we use those three maps, but to define the equivalence relation, we're using those two maps. And the equivalence relation says that the two co-cycles, chi1 and chi2, are equivalent if there exists an element in the group, G and G of B, such that you have this relation. So chi1 and chi2 are sort of conjugated. This is, so using this G and delta 1 of G and delta 2 of G. Okay, so that's the definition of H1. It only depends on B and G, and if you want on the base field. So this is in general this is just a set, and but it's a set with a distinguished point, so you always can take the identity element is always a co-cycle, and that's the distinguished point. And but if G is abelian, then this set naturally carries the structure of an abelian group too. Yeah, so that's the main result now. So we look at isomorphism classes of G torsors that become trivial over B, meaning they have a point in B. And the theorem says that those two things are isomorphic, so this is an isomorphism of pointed sets. And so it says, it, the meaning of this theorem is really, okay, H1 classifies G torsors. So understanding H1 is pretty much the same as understanding the isomorphism classes of G torsors. And the proof, let me give you some idea of the proof. So the proof is really helpful for sort of actually constructing those torsions. So one way is so from a G torsor to a cocycle, that's the easier way. So what you do is you assume that the torsor is trivial over B, and this exactly means that you can find a point x in x of B. Now, choose a point, and then you say, okay, let's look at delta 1 of x and delta 2 of x. So delta 1 of x and delta 2 of x, these are both points in x of p tends to b. And this is a torsor for g of p tends to b. And so you know there exists a unique element, chi, in the group here, transforming one element to the other element. And this is your cocycle. And then what we have to check is that this definition that the equivalence class of chi does not depend on the choice of x. So the other way, the other direction is a little bit harder. So if you're given a cocycle, you have to come up with the torsion. So given a cocycle, what you can do is you can use this cocycle to define a decent datum on G base extended to B. So you know, whenever you have a torsor which is trivial over B, well, if you base extend to B, it's just going to be the group itself. So you know over B is going to look like the group itself. So that's the group itself over B. And then you sort of, but you know it somehow is coming from K. And how it is coming from K can be encoded by what we call a decent datum. And so you can use this chi to actually define a decent datum. But we did some sort of, from decent theory, four different varieties. And this is exactly what you can use here.
In the first part, from torsor to cocycle, I think I am missing something. You are starting by taking a point in x of b.
Yeah.
So this means that you are doing the construction for forces that are trivial over B.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
So this set here is exactly,
yeah.
So this depends on B, and it's exactly those torsors that become trivial over B.
Yeah.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Yeah, everything, like all the isomorphisms are over K, but we assume that it's trivial over some B. B is fixed. B is fixed out all the time, throughout all the time.
This is just a bijection that preserves the single point, right? There's no.
Yeah, exactly. That's all. It's a bijection, and that preserves that specified point. So the identity element, yeah. So this, and here, so here the special point is the class of the trivial torsion. Yeah.
So I'm still missing something, and I'm sorry about the definition. But the sigma, does it continue? Is it the set of
Equivalence
classes over K of torsors that are trivial over B.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, isomorphism is always over K.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, all right. Yeah, that's the main theorem. So we can use H1 to classify the torsors. And then, so to get rid of the B, to sort of get all the torsors, so far we only had torsors becoming trivial over B, but since everyone becomes trivial over some B, if you take the limit, we get all torsors.
Limit over what?
Okay, limit over isomorphism classes of K sigma algebra.
Okay,
you're worried about taking the limit, like set theoretically?
For example.
Yeah, it's. I believe it's fine. We can discuss about it later if you want. But yeah, there's no issue with that.
And is there a given difference closed ring that you have in mind as a big one?
No, you no.
Nothing like this.
No. But you can just look at the set of isomorphisms. So the isomorphism classes are a set. We're taking a limit over a set. So we can take we can say finitely sigma generated. Finitely sigma generated.
Oh, okay.
K sigma algebra speed. Isomorphism classes of that.
Finitely generated, fine.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay.
Alright.
But there is no universal. No.
Yeah, so I don't think there is. Maybe the question is, so what does it mean to be universal? But whatever the definition is, I don't think there is such a thing which is a difference algebra. So, yes.
Does that also depend on the maps from K to B? I mean, could you have two different algebra extensions, B and B prime, that map to a C so that the two maps are different?
So you can do this sort of thing, but it's compatible. So,
the limit really is over the maps between these.
Yeah.
Yes. So you can actually define a partial order. So the isomorphism classes of K sigma algebras, it's a directed set under a certain order, and the order is just that there exists a map from B to B prime. And then so you can form a limit over a directed set. Let's look at this example. So G is the difference algebraic group defined by a linear difference equation, and here we can compute the H1. This is actually, so I said, if the group is abelian, then H1 also has the structure of an abelian group. So this is actually an isomorphism of abelian group. So here we have K, so the additive group of K, modulo the image of the linear difference operator L. And with this description, it's really easy to see that actually any torsor for G is of that form, so it's defined by the linear difference equation, but of the inhomogeneous version. And really, so the bijection is basically given by, so the torsor corresponds to, to A, under to the equivalence class of A, in K mod L. And so it's also, this description is also easy to see, when two such torsors are isomorphic, so XA is isomorphic to XB, if and only if the difference of A and B is L of C for some C in the base. And so this is something you might know from other contexts. So if you have a short exact sequence of different algebraic group, you get a long exact sequence on the cohomology. So here the role of H0, if you want, is played by just taking the k points. And then, in general, so if you have a surjective map of algebraic groups, let's say a quotient map of different algebraic groups, then it's not necessarily true that this map is also surjective on the base field, and somehow you can think that H1 of the kernel is measuring as how far this map is from actually being surjective. So you have this long exact sequence on H1. Okay, so this is a fairly general example. If we have a different algebraic group, you have just an algebraic group. G is just a usual algebraic group, linear algebraic group, and if you have a morphism of algebraic groups from G to the sigma to the D twist of G, this means you just apply sigma to the D to the defining equations of G. This is a new algebraic group, and then using this data, we can define a different algebraic subgroup of G by the equation sigma to the D of G equals phi of G. And now given a torsor X for that algebraic group, so X is just an algebraic variety, it's a torsor for that algebraic group G, And then given a phi from x to the sigma to the d twist of x, such that this compatibility condition is satisfied, we can define a different algebraic subvariety of x by this equation. And then it's not too hard to check that this x is a G torsion. So x is a difference variety, and it's a torsor for the difference algebraic group G. And then the theorem is that any torsor is of the above form, so any G torsor is isomorphic to such a torsor and to such torsors. And you can describe when two such torsors are isomorphic just using this algebraic statement.
Sorry, but so in particular, every group, every difference group is such a G. In particular, right? In particular.
No. For
these,
for G's of this form.
Oh, for that particular G.
Yeah.
Yeah, for that particular G.
I'm sorry, I didn't read for that.
Yeah, for that particular G. Yeah.
Okay, sorry.
Right. And so when we sort of specialize this theorem to the case that the algebraic group has no non-trivial torsors, for example, if the base field is algebraically closed, that would be the case, then one can show that every G torsor is in fact of this fairly explicit form. Then if you specialize even more, then so if you specialize G to GLN, D to 1, and Psi to be this endomorphism of GLN, which maps G to the transpose of the inverse, then you see that the group here from that more general setup specializes to the unitary group, the group we see before, and then this so because so GLN does not have any non-trivial torsors, so the corollary applies to that situation, and then the above corollary shows that indeed any G torsor is of the form as we seen it previously.
So this psi is any map that goes from G to the twisting.
It has to be a morphism of algebraic. Yeah, but it can be anything. And so this is another corollary. For example, for that corollary, you can choose psi to be the map that maps everything to the identity element. It's still a morphism of algebraic group. That's fine. And so in that case, you can show that if the sigma is an automorphism on the base field, then for that particular difference algebraic group G, it's in fact the case that H1 is always trivial. So there's no non-trivial torsors for difference algebraic group length. So in the last minute, I guess, I'll just very briefly mention two applications with this. So I won't say much about this. So there is this, let me just say, there is this Galois theory where the Galois groups are difference algebraic group, and this group measure some difference algebraic relations among the solutions. And the main application is that you can use this H1 to classify the isomorphism classes of the solution rings in this Galois theory. We're not making any assumption on the constant, so it's an interesting question to ask to understand the non-uniqueness of the Picard-Vessiot extension, and the theorem gives the answer insofar it tells you okay the extension is unique even only if the if H1 is trivial. Okay, and the other application I wanted to show is in the direction of the inverse problem. So we're really far from understanding the inverse problem in general for this parameterized Galois theory, but say over that base field where you have the sigma is a shift in alpha, and if you only look at different algebraic subgroups of the additive group, there we can give the answer. So such a subgroup is a sigma Galois group if and only if it's either the full additive group or it is defined by a linear difference equation. And a linear difference equation has to have a very special property, namely that you can find a full solution set in the base field.
What is alpha C alpha?
So alpha and x are just two variables, two independent variables.
Are we talking about some sigma delta equations?
Yes, so we're looking at linear differential equations depending on a discrete parameter alpha. And we're acting on alpha by the shift. So alpha goes to alpha plus 1. Yeah, so the key, sort of just the key idea, like how even how does it happen that those things about torsors are relevant to this Galois theory, is that the solution rings, the Picard-Vessiot rings, if you think of them geometrically, they become torsors for the Galois. And so sort of knowing the structure of the torsors gives you some structural result for the Picard-Vessiot rings actually. But that's all I wanted to say.
Okay. Any additional questions?
For that last theorem, do you know what happens if instead of C alpha x, you just have like f of x, where f is an arbitrary sigma field?
So you replace C of alpha with an arbitrary difference field? Yeah. The same statement holds.
Is it
the case that a torsor, sigma torsor, is a subtorsor of an algebraic torsor? So not only sigma groups live in algebraic groups, but it holds at the torsor level too.
I understand the question. I don't think I ever.
There are no GA torsors.
Pardon?
There are no GA torsors.
What do we know GA torsors?
Yeah. There are.
Not algebraically.
You might have a trivial algebraic torsor, but for the sigma sub, you might take a sigma subgroup, and you might take a PHS for that, which has no point. So you could find a non-trivial difference torsor for a true, you know, which is a subtorsor of a trivial algebraic torsor. I don't know any example of a
torsor which is not contained in an algebraic variety.
But I believe it's true. The same is true in differential velocity. Yeah. I would guess.
When you looked at powers of sigma, you had sigma to the d of x coming from x alone, whereas the natural thing is to have sigma to the d of x coming from x, sigma of x to the squared of x, blah, 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 sigma to the minus first of x. Did anything change?
I'm not clear if this equation sort of is still defined as fine subgroup.
Sure, say you look at I'm used to looking at the multiplicative group, so how about sigma squared of x?
I feel like for the multiplicative group, and even for products of the multiplicative group, we know everything we like to know. Like we can completely describe all torsors for different algebraic subgroups of GM to some power. Yeah, like so that's it. For pretty much all the groups we tried to do it, we actually could do it. So write down a statement like all torsors of that for that difference algebraic group are of a specific form. It's sometimes a bit more complicated to work out when they are isomorphic. It's just the equations become more complicated. But so given the defining equation for the difference algebraic group, so for most of the time, you sort of just have to twist the equations a little bit, like sort of in a clever way enter some coefficient somewhere from the graph here.
Do
you think it is possible to say something on the reduced form of the differential system when you know something on this sigma torsor?
So you start with a linear differential equation.
Yeah, and you know that the sigma Galois group must be something. Then you can compute its cohomology and perhaps have some information on the gauge transform of the system that it might lie.
Yeah. So yeah. Somehow. One idea, which sort of seems to be fruitful. Yeah. So So it doesn't happen much that the torsors are actually trivial, but we can write them down. And so what we can do is, and also the idea for this group is you can write down the equations for the Picard-Vessiot ring, and you can explicitly write down how the group is acting. And this can be helpful in certain situations.
Yeah, that gives me a question, no? For instance, in different philosophy, in many occasions, those different algebraic groups, they are, let's say, Sarisky close into some algebraic group. And then it is clear what is the relationship between these different Galois cohomology and the Galois cohomology of the closures.
Yeah, so we didn't really find anything like that. So that's a very natural question to ask, but it's not clear. Like, so you have this sequence of Sarisky closures somehow, and you have all those algebraic groups, but it's not so clear how the different H, like how the difference H1 is some limit of the algebraic H1s, or how the torsors are really related. We didn't find anything really in that direction.
Any other questions? Okay, thanks.